Hello everybody and welcome to another Manga Thoughts and Opinions video. The disclaimers that used to be listed at the beginning of these videos are now listed at the top of the description down below. It is the 4th of March now today, 2022. It's 3 in the morning. I just got out of bed a couple hours ago. And yesterday, I started reading the next manga after finishing Girls Last Tour. I was just looking around what I owned and was looking, digging around for something to read. I didn't really know, I kind of had this pit in my stomach after finishing that series. So I kind of wanted to dedicate a little bit of time to a smaller series, one that I had the complete set for, but one that wasn't, you know, 10 plus volumes in length. And I settled on Your Name, which is only 3 volumes in total length. And I started reading it yesterday, read the first chapter, then ended up going to sleep, and just finished it this morning. Well, the first volume, at least. Obviously, there's still the other two to go. So this one was kind of picked for that reason, or was picked at random out of the small series that I own. Here we are, I suppose. So let's go over some of the basic stuff for the manga of Your Name. It's an adaptation of the film, which I have seen. I watched the film back on September 5th, 2018. Okay, that was three fucking years ago. God damn it. Why would fucking time, where did it go, man? This is so ridiculous. So I did come into this already knowing about the story, though to be fair, I kind of don't remember some of the details. I only very barely remember the story, but we'll see as we go through the volumes. It's 3 volumes in total, and the first volume here that we're covering is 3 chapters in total. It released in 2016 and finished in 2017. And it is listed as a drama, romance, supernatural, and let's see. So for this particular book, the story is by one Makoto Shinkai. Hopefully I didn't fuck the pronunciation of that too bad. And the art has been done by, I can't read my own handwriting. Now I have to go onto the internet and try to find it. Ranmaru Kotone, basically, I guess. There you go. I didn't use the correct R pronunciation because fuck Japanese R's, man. But, let's talk about it. So, Volume 1 was a pretty good starting point. I don't know how good of an adaptation this is, you know, because there's always a bit of a watery line that people have when it comes to the source material versus the adaptation. But I thought this was a pretty good start. I mean, it's been long enough for me to basically re-experience the story kind of, not blind, but kind of in a way where it's like, oh, okay, I gotta keep refreshing my memory, so each time I come across something in this book, it's gonna be like, oh, wow, okay, oh, yeah, I remember that now that I'm reading it. So the story kind of revolves around two characters, a city boy named Taki and a country girl who I'll just be referring to as Mitsu. So, interestingly, Mitsu actually wishes that she were a boy and lived in a big city like Tokyo, which is ironic because she ends up having a strange dream where she sees herself as a boy in Tokyo. Likewise, a boy finds himself having strange dreams about being a girl in the countryside in a rural village, town sort of place. I don't really know if it's a village or a town. It's very small, though, very rural, where everyone speaks with an accent and seem to be living in somewhat, older ways. Well, obviously, it's not dreams. They're not dreaming at all. It is a body-swapping story, which means that, for starters, that's kind of interesting, but also it's very confusing. Usually, it can be confusing. When there's just two characters, it's much easier to follow, especially when you're watching the film. But in a book, it can be... I was a little bit worried that I was going to be lost on, you know, who's who when they swap, because unless they literally tell me, oh, I am this person today, which they do in the book a few times, I'm going to be lost. But thankfully, I didn't get overwhelmed at all with knowing who's who. Not only were the English translations in the book colored to show, you know, so the boxes that were in white were for one character, and boxes that were colored in black were for another character, if they were body swapped, but they also always acknowledged it. And like I said, when there's only two characters involved in the body swapping, it's much easier to follow, unlike a Kokoro Connect, which had body swapping. And in the anime, I actually found it somewhat confusing to find who was who, because everyone was swapping at all times. And another important factor of the story that actually doesn't play a real big role in this particular volume, but I remember being very significant from the film, though I don't remember exactly why, which is kind of scary, is that there's a comet. There's a comet coming by. It's going to pass by Earth, passes by every 1,200 years, I think it said in the book. And it's going to be passing by, so everyone's getting ready for this, you know, big festival, and everyone's going to be out watching this thing pass by or something like that. At least in the countryside, they're waiting for that. And I'm trying to remember what the significance of the comet was. Damn it, maybe I gotta go back and rewatch the film after it. Just like I want to rewatch Girl's Last Tour after finishing the manga, I feel like I want to go do the same with the film for this one. Anyways, chapter 1, which these chapters are titled just first episode, second episode, third episode, so there's no unique titles to them. But chapter 1 basically is an introduction to the character Mitsu. So we get to follow along with her life. We get to know that she hates where she lives, and that she hates her town, and that she wants to live in a big city, you know, and she talks about how she wants to be a boy and live a boy's life. But we also learn that she had a wild day that she can't remember. The previous day, apparently, she was not acting like herself. She didn't do her hair right. She didn't show up to school on time. You know, she was lost. She didn't know how to get to school. And this is all weird behavior because it's not like her. It doesn't make any sense, right? But regardless, that's... Hold on, my nose is itching. Regardless, that's what she wakes up with and guesses she must have just had a real rough day, a stressful day, whatever the case may be. And we get to see a little bit of that, and clearly this is Taki having taken control of her body. And the first thing he does as a boy in a girl's body is squeeze the boobs. Because, of course, you gotta squeeze the boobs. But she felt like she had a dream as well. Though we don't get to see it directly. But she saw the world through someone else's eyes, basically. And as for more importance to her character, I guess she's kind of a shrine maiden, that she has a very kind of uptight family, almost. And there's a lot of traditional stuff that they have to go through and learn and be taught. And, you know, it's rural stuff, basically. But also, and they have a legacy to, you know, to succeed. So there's her father. I might have been mistaken on this because it wasn't focused on too much, but her father is the mayor, I guess, or running for mayor, and he's kind of a dickhead. At least he acts like it, if that's her father, or at least they have some sort of relation, know each other. So she's constantly under stress. But in her notebook, there is a message that was left for her that she didn't remember writing, and nor does she know who wrote it, stating, "Who are you?" And that's where the chapter ends. Or that's not where the chapter ends, but that's where the chapter kind of leaves off. And clearly, these two characters don't know what's going on. We know what's going on. They think they're just dreaming. But, I mean, you know, to be completely honest, I feel like if I were having a dream where I had swapped with someone else's body and it wasn't actually a dream, I feel like I would be pretty damn aware that it's not a dream within 3 seconds of experiencing something. Because dreams are very, even when they feel very real and then you wake up and realize they're not real, there's certain aspects of a dream that you're able to pick up on when you know it's a dream in the dream, as opposed to, you know, not realizing that it's not real life or whatever. I don't know, fuck it. So chapter 2, second episode, where we now get to focus on the opposite character, Taki, who's a city boy. He has good friends. He has a crush on a girl he works with at a local restaurant. He works as a waiter. Now, keep in mind, we're seeing Taki's life through Mitsu, who wakes up in his body. And she does respond to "Who are you?" by writing on Taki's arm her name, so that when he swaps back into his body, he'll see the name of this girl that has apparently been swapping with him or whatever, or vice versa. Though, of course, keep in mind, by this point, they still think it's a dream. They don't really know what's going on, and she's just taking it in. And this is somewhat relatable, too, for me, because I would like to live in a big city, and Tokyo was my original goal to live in a couple years ago. So to see her react to coming out of the house, out of Taki's house, and looking at this, you know, the city skyline was, I don't know, it was kind of cute to see that reaction, because it feels like something that I've longed for as well myself. But thankfully, by the end of this chapter, pretty quickly, considering how short manga actually is once you start reading it, they both put together that it's not really a dream and that they are switching bodies. They don't know why, but they don't give a shit. They know it's happening by now. So they accept that it's happening. Which, in chapter 3, which is our next chapter, if I can flip my note page over without getting confused here, they start sort of setting ground rules for each other, you know, don't do this or that or this and whatever, and, you know, and make sure you do it this way, etc., to kind of help each other out in a way, but more played up to be kind of comedic. So they tend to be swapping 2 to 3 times a week, and they say that about a month has passed, if not a little bit more than a month has passed. Because they're both influencing each other's lives. So when they're swapped and the other one, you know, isn't in control of their own body, the opposite person is getting up to trouble, could be making them out to look really cool, giving them new skills, you know, or they're speaking, like, for example, Taki would speak with an accent when Mitsu was in his body because she comes from a rural area, and people picked up on that immediately. So, for example, Mitsu, while in Taki's body, actually snags a date with someone named Okudera, I guess, I think is her name, if I remember correctly, who's a girl that he works with at the restaurant and has a crush on. Well, she gets real sweet with him. I say Mitsu gets real sweet with her while in Taki's body. Which, of course, would send Taki insane, because, I mean, I would totally relate to that, to swap and then wake up not knowing what happened the previous day, and suddenly I've got a date with the girl that I like, and I was not prepared at all for it, you know, I didn't mentally prepare even a minute for it, I'd be going insane too. So he kind of has to rush and go on this date with this woman that Mitsu kind of wanted to go on herself, but if they swapped, she wanted to make sure that he was ready for it as well, and kind of left like links to various websites or whatever to help him get ready for a date, since she assumes that he's never been on a date before. And unfortunately, it goes kind of bad. It's kind of a train wreck of a date, probably because he wasn't prepared for it in the slightest, and because both Mitsu and Taki have completely different personalities. This girl came to know Mitsu's personality through Taki, a feminine side, you know, very, very acting, very cute, very nice and kind. And Taki himself is, you know, can be a bit of a klutz. So when he's taken over and doesn't realize what's really going on, of course, the opposite person's going to pick up on that in a relationship or the beginnings of a relationship. And she even says, you know, it feels like you liked me a day ago, but now it feels like maybe there's someone else you like, which, to be fair, I don't know if there really is any romance blooming this early. I think his mind is just on Mitsu, because that's what he's been kind of putting up with the past month, is going through her life and learning about her family and her friends and, you know, where she lives and stuff. And so that's why he's so distracted by everything. So this comes with, I think the ending of the chapter focuses on the comet is approaching, and Mitsu, in her body, wonders if Taki is also going to be watching the comet pass by at the same time, just from different places in Japan. And she writes this down in his notebook, because they share messages with each other through their notebooks and stuff, and I think even through texts. I say even through texts, but I don't know if they're texting, like, live to each other. They're leaving behind messages on each other's phones, something like that. But regardless, he reacts to the message about seeing this comet and says, I don't know anything about a comet. I know nothing about a comet. And strangely, ever since that day, Mitsu and I stopped swapping bodies, and that's how the book ends. So, a little bit of mystery sprinkled on there. Not only does he not know about any comet, which you would assume if a comet that passes by every 1200 years was going to pass by and be seeable, the whole fucking world's gonna know about it, you know, it's gonna be all over the news. And for a kid living in the city, he's going to be blasted with all of that kind of media at all sides, so you would think that he would know about it at least in some form. I mean, I believe even Mitsu brings up, through Taki's body, the comet with Taki's friends, and they have no idea what he's talking about. So why did it stop? Why did the body swapping stop? Why doesn't he know about the comet? I think I remember slightly, but I can only speculate because it's based on memory from 3 years ago. What I think, if I remember correctly, is it's kind of a bit of a plot twist. So obviously, if you're watching this as a first-timer to Your Name, then this could be considered spoilers. But if I remember correctly, I think it's either... I think my cat shit. What the hell? Something stinks. It's either the fact that... See, I remember the fact that Mitsu is... Okay, they have Mitsu's village that she lives in, right? Kind of looks like a big crater. And if I remember correctly, the comet hits the village, doesn't it? Isn't that what it does? Or like a shard of it breaks off and destroys the town or something like that? And it turns out that Mitsu is actually from the past and is somehow connecting to a kid from the future, you know, present day. So they feel like they're both in their own present times, but little do they know they're like decades apart from each other or something like that. But then that wouldn't explain the phone, I guess. I just remember something like that the town gets destroyed when the comet arrives. And then once they realize this and start putting it together, they're able to body swap to help one another. I don't know. Maybe I'm thinking of a different story, but I think that's kind of what happens. And that would explain why after the comet came, Mitsu stopped body swapping. It would also explain why nobody knows about the comet that Mitsu knows about, because they're from two different time periods. So there wouldn't be a comet flying by. And there's a picture on the wall that Taki sees in, I don't know if it's at like a museum or at the cinema or something, which looks like the village that Mitsu lives at, and it's a big crater hole, you know? And he says, that seems kind of familiar, which would imply that in his timeline, the town was destroyed by the comet, or the comet had struck there, so there would be pictures of it, you know, hanging up on the wall, maybe pictures of before the comet hit hanging up on the wall, and that's why he finds it familiar. But because, you know, it's a rural area, you just really aren't going to remember that kind of thing. You know, it's like, it would be like, oh, yeah, that town burned down 20 years ago, but you're not going to know about it because it has nothing to do with you. It doesn't concern you until you actually dig into its history. That's, again, pure speculation based off of the loose memories I have of the film. So, unless... well, there is no unless. It's just a matter of reading the next two volumes to see if that lines up correctly with what I remember. If it's not that, I think it's something similar, because I know the comet is important to the story. It's not just there to, you know, look at and be pretty while wearing, you know, a yukata or something. It's literally something that happens to affect the story. Important. Another thing that they do multiple times from the very first chapter all the way through to the third one is they both wake up crying sometimes, and they don't really realize or understand why. I don't remember either why they're crying, but they are. And I don't know if it's like Mitsu who's the one that's tinkling from the eyeballs and that, you know, kind of leaks over onto Taki. I'm not sure, but they both acknowledge that they wake up crying but don't know why. And that's it. That's all there is to Your Name. Very short, only three chapters, though the chapters are going to feel like books in length compared to Girl's Last Tour, where every chapter was 4 or 5 pages long. So, yeah. The only thing I have to complain about so far is, of course, the fact that I can't go... Anime was already bad enough, but now even in book form, I can't go one fucking book without somebody sneezing or claiming that they're gonna catch a cold for the dumbest, most retarded reasons on the planet. And this book does it too, and it's so freaking annoying to have to deal with that every single time I try to enjoy something from anywhere. But regardless, aside from that, despite that, I quite enjoyed this book so far, and I'm looking forward to volumes 2 and 3. And as far as I can tell, volume 2 is much shorter than volume 1, and volume 3 is shorter than volume 1, but longer than volume 2. So they're kind of a little bit mix and match with their lengths. Anywho, that's going to bring this particular discussion to an end, so I'll see you in the next episode, which will, of course, be Your Name Volume 2, presumably. And then after that will be Your Name Volume 3. Don't know exactly if I'm going to read it right now, or if I'm going to read it later, or tomorrow, because there are some other things I wanted to do, but we'll see. Either way, pretty happy with my activity recently, and I'm looking forward to what's coming in the next coming days. I said coming twice. God damn it.